Good afternoon once again. Welcome to the sixth lecture of the Professor E.G. Ramachandran Distinguished Lecture Series. May I now invite Professor K. Padmanabhan to come over the dais. I request Ms. Lavanya to hand over a fruit basket to Professor K. Padmanabhan.
I hope it will be a fruitful meeting.
May I now request Professor Ganesh Sundaraman, Head of the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering, to come to the dais. Professor Kamaraj, Chairman of the Professor EGR Distinguished Lecture Series Committee, to come on dais. And I also request Professor M. Balasubramanian, who is the chairman of IIM Chennai chapter, and Professor Murthy, who is the convener of the EGR Distinguished Lecture Series Committee, to come out, come to the dais, please. May I now request Professor Ganesh to address the gathering?
Good afternoon. Because of want of time, I don't want to name, of course, the speaker and guest. So we'll straight away go to the address. As you know, this is the sixth lecture of the Professor E.G. Ramachandran Distinguished Lecture Series. We know that we have been doing this, conducting this for the past few years. For the last 5 years, actually, we were fortunate to have Professor E.G. Ramachandran with us, who graced the occasion, all the occasions he was here, attending the lecture, making remarks, and giving advice to all of us. But this year, we miss his physical presence. But we have, of course, remembrance. We have, of course, we can remember him, and then we will remember him and his contributions. So for this afternoon, first part of the events, actually we have the lecture to be given by Professor K. Padmanabhan. Then we have, after the talk, we have the establishment of Professor E.G. Ramachandran Chair at IIT Madras. Then we will have a separate session on reminiscences on Professor E.G. Ramachandran. This will be coordinated by Mr. B. Muthuraman, Vice Chairman, former Vice Chairman, Tata Steel, and also, of course, he is a distinguished alumnus, IIT Madras. Incidentally, of course, Professor E.G. Ramachandran taught him also. Then a booklet actually has been prepared, which is titled as Professor E.G. Ramachandran, Remembering Professor E.G. Ramachandran, at Teacher Par Excellence, so that will be released by Professor Ranganathan, and so that is the program we have for this afternoon. And I'm glad that many of you have come and assembled here, and I also noticed that some of you have come far away from, far away places. You have come here to pay tribute to our great Pithamahar of Metallurgy, our first HOD, first professor of this department, IIT Madras. And I also noticed that former colleagues of Professor EGR have come here, and former students of Professor EGR have come here, and many students also have come here, staff members, and friends from industries, they have come here. Even though it is afternoon on Saturday, still, of course, you could find time to come here, mainly to show our affection and to mark our respect to Professor EGR. And thanks a lot. Many of you, many of course, admirers of Professor EGR could not come here, But they'll be watching the proceedings because the webcast is going on. So yeah, welcome, warm welcome to all of you. And we will look forward to the lecture by Professor KAP, and then subsequently we will have the session on the remembering Professor EGR, wherein many of you who have closely associated, who have worked with Professor EGR, to share their experiences with us. So with this, I will once again welcome you on behalf of IIT Madras, and in particular, the Department of MME at IIT Madras. Thank you.
Professor B.S. Murthy is the convener of the Professor E.G. Ramachandran Distinguished Lecture Series Committee. I would like to request Professor Murthy to say a few words about the committee and about the lecture series.
Good afternoon, friends. Welcome once again. As Professor Ganesh mentioned, all this started about 5 years back when one of the alumnus and a great admirer of Professor EGR donated some fund towards this. And then immediately a number of people contributed to this fund, with which we have started this lecture series, which we call it as Professor E.G. Ramachandran Distinguished Lecture Series. And every year, it was actually, though we actually formed a committee for which Professor Kamraj is the chairman, I am the convener, and we have two colleagues, and Ravi Kumar, who is the current Master of Ceremony today, and Fani from here, Professor Ranganathan, and Dr. Sundarajan, who was from ARCI and now a colleague of ours, and also Atul Choksi and Mr. Muthuraman, who is sitting here. They're all members of this committee, and the committee's basic role is to conduct this program and also select the speaker every year. But luckily, last 5 years, we have been having Professor EGR being there with us and then suggesting as a possible distinguished people, both from industry and academia, for this lecture series. And that is how this program started, with Professor Ranganathan giving the first talk, 2013. As you can see, Mr. Muthuraman the second, and Dr. Deepankar Banerjee. Each of them are stalwarts in their own fields. And Professor Prabhakar last year, and now we have Professor Padmanabhan amongst us. We are all waiting for that lecture series. This year alone, we did not have that fortune of having Professor EGR suggesting as the name. And from now onwards, it is this committee which has to take this forward. But as Dr. Ganesh mentioned, though he is not here amongst us, all his students who are all here, all his colleagues, admirers, his family members, Lakshmi, and his daughter, one of his daughters, she has come all the way from Delhi, and her husband Sandy, both of them are with us, and other family members are also amongst us. So he is being represented here by all of you, and so we feel that he is here listening to all of us and blessing us from higher up there, so that we take this idea forward and keep doing this year after year with more and more vigor and more energy and passion. And I'm sure this would be a memorable event every year, year after year. With that, thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Murthy. Professor K. Padmanabhan is the distinguished speaker for today. I now request Professor Panikumar to introduce the speaker.
Professor K. Anantha Padmanabhan has obtained his BSc Metallurgy, a 5-year integrated program from Banaras Hindu University in 1968. And he held at that time the university first rank and all the 3 gold medals that were possible. He took his PhD from the University of Cambridge, UK in 1972. And the University of Cambridge also conferred on him the highest academic degree, Doctor of Sciences, in 1998. Professor Padmanabhan started his academic career as a faculty member in BHU, and 1972 to 79 he worked there. And in 1980, he came to IIT Madras as a professor, and then he has taken up leadership roles here as the head of the department and then the dean of academic research in IIT Madras. And later on, he also was the director of IIT Kanpur. Towards the end of his academic career at Kanpur, he then also moved to Germany for a short stay and then came back to serve as dean in the University of Hyderabad and then in Anna University as professor of eminence. And he was one of those stalwarts on whose shoulders we have been sitting around and not knowing. Professor Padmanabhan is the founder chairman of Center for Continuing Education. He was the founder chairman of GATE for the first 2 years it was held. Professor Padmanabhan has attracted a huge fund in those days, 3.2 million marks, to establish the materials testing lab in our department. And materials testing lab was the state of the art in the world and had attracted postdoctoral fellowships from abroad, from Germany. And Professor Padmanabhan was the founder professor in charge for the Center of Nanotechnology in University of Hyderabad, which just finished celebrating 10 years of its existence. Professor Padmanabhan founded the Siemens Center of Excellence in Life Cycle Management and the Center of Technology and Development and Transfer in Anna University. Professor Padmanabhan has been honored with the fellowships of all the academies that we could think of, INE, Indian Academy of Sciences, National Academy of Sciences, Institute of Metals in UK, Institute of Engineers, Indian Institute of Metals, and so on. Professor Padmanabhan was a recipient of Alexander von Humboldt Research Fellowship in 1985, and then he was the first Indian to be given the Humboldt Forschungs Prize in 1994. He was also the first Indian to receive the guest scientist program for outstanding researchers from abroad from the University of Karlsruhe. So today we have an outstanding scientific personality here, and I would not like to take any more time from here to invite Professor Padmanabhan to deliver his lecture.
Yeah, already what is in the ground.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Yes. Pointer.
It's ready.
Okay. It will come in full? Okay. Very good afternoon to all of you. After this introduction, I feel a bit nervous. Already I was very nervous and I have become worse because with that kind of a word, I don't know about whom he was talking when the introduction was being made. You know, it's a very difficult job to do for me because the first speaker under this series was Professor Ranganathan, who is not just any professor, but he was almost part of EGR's family because his eldest brother, Professor Sampat, anyone whom he had known Professor Sampat would be in love with that man. And Ranganathan being his youngest brother, Professor, EGR used to always look upon him as part of the family. And then, you know, followed by four of his very illustrious students, Muthuraman, Dipankar Banerjee, Krishnadas Nair, and Prabhakar. I am actually a grand student of Professor EGR because he is a student of his student, Professor Anantharaman. So to that extent, you know, one generation down. So that is the kind of a thing. But on the other hand, I always recall Professor Anantharaman with great affection because just with one letter, he managed to send me to Cambridge. I am one of the very few, I think, who got a fellowship to do PhD without applying to University of Cambridge. I didn't have an admission. I didn't have a college to go to. But I had a research grant thanks to that great man. But the same man told my wife, in 2003, three of my students, Professor Ramarao, Professor Ramachandran Rao, and Padmanabhan, have done better than me. Obviously, they have some additional skills which I do not have. I don't know from where they learned. Ramachandran Rao is no more to explain. If you can get out of Professor Ramarao any sentence, whoever gets it, I will give him an award. But I am a fellow who, shoots off his mouth quite readily, so I will tell you how. And this is where Professor EGR comes in. You see, basically, I learned from three other persons. Professor Anantharaman set all my goals as far as academics is concerned. But in terms of administration and in decision making, I learned a lot from Professor Indireshan. He always used to tell me, the big people will always want you to do something out of the way. But you are already a professor, what more do you want? Be bold. On the first instance itself, say, no, it is not possible, everything will be all right. And he also taught me, before you open a file, set up all the criteria. After that, you look into the file, because if you already see some fellow, he is not meeting some qualification, you may not do that. So sense of fair play. And the other thing, he also said, never give up on your goal, but then also remember there is something known as convenience of management. So achieve your goal, maybe in 2-3 steps, don't bluntly do it. The second man was Professor C.V. Sundaram. From him I learned one important thing. Leave every relationship always with something positive on your credit. Then you know there will be no sourness. And that man, I mean, you know, if I knew anyone in my life for whom the gap between his words and deeds, it was least, it was C.V. Sundaram. Third man was Professor EGR. Professor EGR, from him I learned strategies, attitude towards life. You know, he, like all of us, you know, might want something. But then, you know, his philosophical approach, something which really stunned me. I mean, you know, as the Bhagavad Gita says, living like water on a lotus leaf, he will never bother. And then, you know, Padmanabhan will tell you know, you think about it, you know, these are all not great things. Far more important is to be happy. And to recall, I mean, you know, he once told me about Professor Antaraman. He said, I taught him metallurgy and tennis. He never learned any tennis. In metallurgy, he did better than me. But on the other hand, I wish he learned some tennis, because he would know that you had to take defeat and success with equanimity. So this was EGR for you. This is a main thing I learned from him. And once Dr. Ashundi and Dr. Krishnan, both from Atomic Energy, were there. He phoned me and said, would you like to come? They are here. They were asking about you. I went there. Then, you know, something they were saying, and matter got very serious, and Professor Iyer tried to calm them down, saying that, well, you know, it is like breathing in life. I thought it was going very seriously. So I said, excuse me, did you say breathing? Then everyone laughed, and then they said, this is true EGR, not Antaraman. Because EGR knew how to diffuse a situation, and that is a lot. And in, you know, because you often come across ticklish situations, how to handle it without losing what you want to do, but at the same time doing with great finesse. These were things, you know, which really helped me. And I was also lucky. Because when Professor E.G. Ramachandran came, you know, I joined in 80, he retired in 85. 82, I became the head of the department. So when his retirement was coming, I was the head of the department. So it was my good luck. Professor Prabhakar is here. He, in fact, came to me and said, we should do something to retain him beyond his retirement. And at that time, he was accompanied by KJL Iyer, whom the student, you know, KJL Iyer. So the students used to always call him as IJKL. IJKL was a very amicable man. And these two people came to me and said, we should do something. And I said, simple, you write a letter for me saying that make them as honorary professor emeritus for 2 years. And Professor Srinath approved it without any problem. And before I went to Germany on a Humboldt Fellowship at the time, I constituted a committee again with Professor Prabhakar as the convener. And you know, one of the things is Professor Prabhakar always used to tell me, I can arrange any marriage without any problem, because he is such a good organizer of these things. And it was in very safe hands, and that was also celebrated very much. This is the kind of a personal touch I want to give to this talk. I have agreed with Murthy that in that the session to be conducted by Mr. Muthuraman, I will be out of the picture, and therefore, because others should have a chance. So this is my personal touch as far as this talk is concerned. Now I would like to go into a problem which is very important to the steel industry. And in fact, you know, I am glad to say at the opening itself that already, of course, Tata Steel is our beta partner. That means, you know, whatever we have developed is being implemented in Tata Steel Holland and in Jamshedpur. And if there are any kind of feedbacks which will be used to improve it, make it more user-friendly and so on. So for that, you know, 1 year they get it completely free. From the second year onward, there will be some charges. Anyway, you know, that the managers will agree. And also we are implementing it in Bombardier. So that means, you know, this is something which is catching up very well in industry. We are already, you know, in talk with TI and others. So therefore, many companies are interested. That means, you know, nothing should be viewed in silos. Everything should be viewed in an integrated form. This is the kind of a philosophy with which it starts. But then, you know, that will be a very complex picture I will present. But at the same time, for the benefit of the students who are here, I would like to say two things. Number one is, you know, if you see any problem, you will find, if you think deeply, you will realize that there are only very few ideas. The rest are all details. Similarly, complexity should not be confused with simplicity. An idea may be simple, but when you add too many things, it may look complex. So therefore, you know, I would like the students to keep it in mind. Then, you know, you will understand things very easily. Because details you can always learn, but fundamentals are important. So, you know, for example, I would like to recall only one sentence from Alice in Wonderland. You know, there is the Red Queen, you know, asked the question, what is 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1 plus 1? Then, you know, poor Alice says, I don't know, I have lost count. She cannot do addition, says the Red Queen. So that means, you know, even 1 plus 1 plus 1, if it is added so many times, it becomes a difficult problem for you. So that is what the situation is. Therefore, what I am going to do, if you understand your Bernoulli's equation, if you understand your Navier-Stokes equation, if you understand your finite element analysis, any problem can be solved. So that is the kind of a message I want to give you. So now, what I am going to present is not my work, it is the work of an entire team. You know, there are three things, J.R.D. Tata said, three things which are important for success. One is the level of technology, the two is the quality of manpower, and the third is the most important thing, money or resources. And luckily, TCS, you know, when we were asked how many people you want to start this program, we took a guess and said 25. Within 6 months, we had the sanction, but we took 2.5 years to recruit the 25 because you can't have anyone working on this problem. So today, here there is a man, B.P. Gautam. B.P. Gautam, by the way, is a product of IIT Madras. He did his PhD with in applied mechanics, a student of Professor N. Ganeshan, who unfortunately is not with us, same age group as myself, Narayanan, and others. So therefore, you know, therefore he knows me from my undergraduate days. It is a big thing. And as I used to tell the CTO, whenever I say something, if he doesn't say, I don't agree with you, sir, I get worried. I will always ask him, what is it? You know, are you all right? Is your temperature okay? Is the wife all right? I will immediately go to, if he agrees with me, I wonder why he agrees. So that is the kind of atmosphere we have had. It's a glorious relationship. And there is this man, Amarendra Singh. Amarendra Singh is also slightly older than Gautam. He is from IIT Kanpur. Under external registration, he got a PhD from my hand. I mean, you know, you should not disqualify him from that ground. Anyway, he got his PhD from those days. So therefore, you know, these two are working with me. So everything went off very smoothly. Of course, the rest of them we have picked out from all. And one thing I would like to say, that not one person is from the IIT. IIT means, I mean the real IITs, the major IITs. Not the new ones, either, of course, there is one fellow from Bhuvaneswar, I mean, one exception. All the others are from these major IITs or from IISc. So this is the kind of a team, and today, Amarendra Singh has become a professor at IIT Kanpur. So B.P. Gautam leads the entire team, and Gautam today supervises the work of about 50 people. Because TCS has got the, you know, one good system. Like we have technicians and so on, we have got, we work on three E's, explore, enable, evangelize, exploit. So exploit, of course, is not our job. We have got some members to enable. That means routine kind of a job, they will take care of it so that the serious thinkers need not waste their time. So this way, this arrangement goes. So this, what I am going to say is the output of 90 people. And here you see, first, you know, I would like to say, what is this concept? This is integrated. Word itself explains. So view everything together, do not view anything in silos. So that means there are two things, you know, you can look at it in two ways in industry. One is, of course, you know, ICME is the short form of Integrated Computational Materials Engineering. There is also one more thing, I will come to that in detail, a little bit more detail. This is called Material Genomic Initiative, that is starting from quantum mechanics. And the next one is digital thread. What is digital thread? You have got the blast furnace, steel making furnace, of course, sintering plant, you know, you can even start from that coke oven onwards, right down to the sheet that is produced. Each of them is an individual operation. In fact, some people from industry are asking me, Bhaskar is not there, otherwise I would have requested him to examine it. Now they want to know whether we can develop a course in, you know, now already we have systems engineering. Can you make system of systems engineering? Because you see, blast furnace has got nothing to do with cold rolling mill. So therefore, these are totally different things. So that means so many systems are integrated into a thing. So that is the kind of a complexity you have. So all of them, we connect digitally. So that is the digital thread. But then, you know, what, how does it help you? Unless you bring in machine learning, that is artificial intelligence, then more importantly, data analytics. With data analytics, you whatever is going on in the blast furnace, you try to understand. And then, you know, you require a certain compositional control. Sulfur cannot be more than this. I mean, you know, sulfur, as you know, requires a reducing atmosphere. If you don't remove sulfur in the blast furnace, you are stuck with it in the steel making. That is why we introduce secondary steel making. And so therefore sulfur, etc. is there. So that means blast furnace has to be fully understood, for which, you know, you use the data analytics. And when you do all that, you really understand what is going on in each of these units, and that gives rise to digital twins. So that means this is the digital twin of what is going on. In other words, on the computer you are simulating whatever is going on inside whatever unit that you are considering. And then you connect all of them. This gives rise to Internet of Things. Internet of Things, you know that, you know, you might have seen recently, this is one of the biggest successes we have had in recent times. TCS signed not very long ago, about 2-3 months ago, in 1 month, you know, we signed about $6 billion contract. You know, this is something like a peak. With IoT, that is Internet of Things, we signed with the aerospace division of Rolls-Royce, because you see, this is the platform and competitors were Microsoft, TCS one, £70 million, and annual maintenance is about 20% of it. So therefore, this kind of a thing, for the first time, you know, high tech is pushing the business initiatives of TCS rather than putting health insurance policy papers on computers. So therefore, you know, things are changing. And when you do the IoT also, then you have a virtual factory. That means whatever is going on in the factory, you can simulate it in the industry. So therefore, this is there. If you look at it the other way, that is the manufacturing operations will go the other way. That is, you start with the operation and run it back. So that means basically what we are doing is accelerated product development comes. Here, of course, you know, leverage whatever is available in the labs and plant, reduce the prototyping and experiments, remove the design silos. That means I don't design something only for my job. It must be fitting in with another and so on. So therefore, it has to be done in an integrated way. And this leads to enhanced manufacturing. Manufacturing integration. Here, of course, you know, whatever you learn from plant and product quality data, whatever is available, in other words, you do this operation, this quality can be ensured. And then, you see, the man on the shop floor has to take decision immediately. I can, as a professor, sit back and say, you did this wrong, that wrong. But the fellow on the spot, you know, has only a few minutes to decide. So therefore, decision support you have to give him. That also is being done by the computer. And then integrated process optimization. In other words, if I have a process, so many chains are there, it is not enough that I do one or two, I should be able to take a holistic view and then optimize. In other words, let us say Muthuraman, he wants to produce steel means, he would like to produce at a particular quality, at a particular amount, and not exceeding certain costs. So that means, you know, these are very complex decisions, multi-criteria decision making. These kind of things also have to be done. And then the third level when you go to is knowledge-driven engineering. That means, you know, you have experts. I know something about metal forming, someone else knows something about something. But all these things should be available in such a way that it should be captured at the right time. and then capture the domain knowledge in a systematic way. And in fact, you know, all the advanced concepts of computer science is being used here. When I have data, I mean, you know, I should know how to handle it. That means storage, management, retrieval. I mean, in other words, if I want some information, it should be available instantaneously in real time. Writing programs for that is not a joke. So that is the way it goes. So that means, you know, today, digital thread and digital twins are unbelievably good tools for us. For example, think of atomic energy. Everything is radioactive. So therefore, if you can simulate whatever is going on in the lab, sitting in an air-conditioned room, that will be a very good one. Or Bombay High, oil, offshore production of oil and so on. So these are all things, highly risky things, and if you can control everything from here, and there one or two fellows occasionally go and visit and so on, it makes life very easy. Then, you know, in the year 2008, the first, now I go to what we have done. First definition of IoT, definition of ICME, Integrated Computational Materials Engineering, was given by the National Academy of Sciences, USA, in the year 2008. They, in fact, said materials manufacturing and component design should be all understood and finalized even before production, even before you think of a operation to start. It is like, you know, it is said that in St. Columbus, Delhi school, as soon as a man and a woman get married, they apply for admission for their child because, you know, about 5-6 years later, there is some possibility of the child getting admission. Something similar to that you should do, you should have decided everything before you start the operation. Then in that case, there is chances of trial and error and loss, loss of time, loss of money, all these things are minimal. So this is the way they said, materials, manufacturing and process components, long before they are fabricated, must be thought of in an integrated way. And you see, this is something I want to confuse you. You know, there are operations at various levels. This is DFT means density functional theory, that is ab initio calculation, electronic interactions and so on. On that, you have so many software today available commercially. And then this is MD simulation, molecular dynamics. There again, you know, so many are there. And then here, microstructural evolution and evolution of materials response, for that so many are there. And here, by the way, thermocalc is mentioned here. Hari Kumar of this department actually worked on its development. And then, you know, you have got many of the micros is a famous one. And this is oof. It is not the bark of a dog. Oof helps you to convert an image into digital information. This will be, this is very essential for doing finite element analysis. Because you see, if I take a picture, I should know how much volume it represents, how much this face, how much volume represents, that face, how much volume represents. So that, you know, is done with the help of this oof. And then, you know, you have this, many of you may be familiar in the macro scale, you know, many of these projects. But you see, they are so costly. Therefore, you know, no one, you know, basically company like TCS would not like to touch it. Because it will, finally they will have to add it to the cost. The license is quite high. And then, you know, ultimately customer will have to pay and so your product. Because so what we try to do, OOF is, for example, in open source. So you, to the extent possible, you use open source or write your own codes. And when it is unavoidable, for example, ANSYS, Abacus, these are all things, you know, available everywhere. I mean, you know, IIT, if you go to any lab, you will find Abacus and ANSYS almost. That is the kind of a thing. It is plenty. So these are all things, you know, which are relatively cheap and very popular. Everyone will have, therefore no one will mind. So otherwise, all the other things you have to prepare. So that is the kind of, that means, you know, earlier, I remember in my student days, people used to say, if you want to get good marks in metallurgy, if you go and see a table, notice board, you should be able to repeat within 2 minutes whatever is there on the notice board without seeing it again. So this kind of memory emphasis is now no longer there. It has to be quantitative. I mean, you know, long ago, Lord Kelvin said, unless you make your ideas quantitative, you add very little to science. But still, you know, unfortunately, it was not thought of so seriously in metallurgical field. Today, you know, it is very much a reality. And now, looking at the events, where did we start? You know, I told you National Academy of Science defined it, but in the year 2011, Materials Genome Initiative in the month of November was announced by President Barack Obama, where he said, we want to start from the quantum mechanics down to the automobile, so everything has to be done with computational techniques. By the way, I may mention, I'm very proud to say this, TCS started it in the month of February 2011. So we started before Obama's announcement. And then, you know, it became 2013, this is the cross-cutting, you know, how it helps in aerospace, automotive, all kinds of industries. That was published, this is again a volume, very big volume, and TMS report on multi-scale gaps. So that means, you know, this is again a very major problem. If you are working in quantum mechanics, you develop to some level. Then you go to the microstructural level, there is again gap. Who will fill this gap? So it is, you know, they consider it is two coarse for them. Microstructural physics people consider this is too fine for them. So therefore some no man's land. So that means these are the problems which really create headaches. Because you think that it is the other fellow's problem. So therefore, how to sort it out? That was brought out in 2015, and then, you know, last one is the TMS report on material data infrastructure. You see, this is, now, you know, people say that a new science is developing. That is, originally there was the experimental science, then, you know, theoretical science, then computational science, now they say data science. You see, the English writer Addison said knowledge is power. So therefore, you know, now you think that if you collect all the data, you will be extremely powerful. So therefore, a new thing which is known as data science is coming. I always tell my group, all the other groups also in TCS, make sure that it is not different. It is definitely different from astrology. Astrology was also data science. Only thing is, so that means, you are assuming that, when there is something, there is a signal, and there is a tail. Tail is known as noise. So you assume when you do this data analysis that the tail or the noise doesn't have any pattern. If you are not careful, you may attribute to the noise all the qualities you are attributing to the, you should have attributed to signal. So therefore, you know, you have to be extremely careful. So it has to be backed up by other techniques. But still, you know, now people are very hopeful that data science will become a fourth branch of knowledge. And this is there. Now we come to actual steel. In steel, what are the problems we have? You know, blast furnace is something, you know, we have left out. Because we have been asked to look into by our partners the steel making part. So therefore, you know, the steel comes out of the basic oxygen furnace, and then, you know, it comes to the ladle. In the ladle, you know, you want a particular chemistry, you want a particular temperature. From the ladle, you know, it goes to the tundish. What is the, you know, how many students are here and how many are you taught actually steel? IIT Kanpur, I heard some time ago, now A.K. Singh has changed it. Steel making was an optional subject. I mean, it is disastrous. Even Parikar, before he went into the hospital, told me that only thing I remember about metallurgy is iron carbon diagram. So those of us, because it seems his teacher told him it seems it should be part of your DNA. So today, if you are studying steel making in optional, there is something seriously wrong. Because but for steel and cement, today civilization cannot exist. So anyway, coming back to this, so here you see, what is the need for a tundish? Something should be available to the caster continuously. And therefore, it comes there. And you take the tundish to make, of course, you know, there is some cooling. Because that, you know, furnace is left, it has left the furnace, come to here, of course, some heating will be there. But even then, you know, there is some cooling. Because of that, precipitation will take place. And once that means inclusions will come. And again, to make it interesting for Mr. Muthuraman, if you don't sell it to auto industry, you have to sell it at one-third the price. So therefore, you cannot allow inclusion level to go beyond a certain point. So therefore, next thing you have to take into account is inclusion. And if you control, I mean, for that, you see, you have to put some, you know the word dam, which is, you know, you dam a river and things like that. And the other one is we use words like weir and gate and all that. I mean, these are all similar ideas, only depending upon the size you use. Whatever it is, this is mainly to block the inclusions, because the liquid will flow around it. The inclusions will drop. So that will be one way of physical separation. And then, you know, that is also what is known as ladle refining, and that I will talk about later. So that means the inclusion level should be kept very, very critically low. And then when you do that, you go to the caster. At the end of the casting, what you want to have? Homogeneous slab with minimal number of inclusions and minimum defects. And there you want to have grain size good, solid solution in the ash-cast form, primary phases that precipitate out, the precipitates that are there. From the solidification stage, it gets into the hot rolling. Of course, you have to reheat and then you do the hot rolling. And then, you know, you cool it, then you cold roll it. After that, you know, here there is a batch or continuous annealing. So, you see, this is, you know, for example, for the Tata Steel project, we were told they want to optimize the dual phase steel. So dual phase steel is a very popular steel, and for that, you know, you have to have some last step is intercritical annealing. Intercritical annealing means you anneal it in the temperature range but where ferrite exists and the one is fully gamma, fully austenitic in between. That range you have to do it so that you get the right proportion of alpha and martensite. I mean a martensite and ferrite. So this proportion, for this you see you have to have. For example, here again, you know, we have to think differently. What Tata Steel Jamshedpur has is a batch annealing facility. Whereas more advanced facilities available in Holland, which is a continuous. Continuous annealing is much better because here, you know, what you do is you make something which weighs about 2 tons, coil it up and put it there. So, you know, there is a temperature gradient possible. I mean, you know, batch annealing is a very difficult process to control. And if at the end of which properties are met, kudos to those engineers. So that, you see, is the batch annealing. And that means, you know, modeling will have to change for that. Similarly, as far as the caster is also concerned, you have a normal caster as far as Jamshedpur is concerned. But in Holland, what you have is a thin slab caster. The thin slab caster has got its many advantages, you know, segregation will not be a problem, columnar grade will not be a problem. So therefore, you know, there are some advantages. But then, you know, once you are stuck with a particular type of technology, you have to do it until its lifetime is over. Only when you are thinking of the new installations, you will go for the new technology. So that means product requires strength, ductility, formability, fatigue and so on. But the plant limitations, I told you, each plant has its own limitation, it depends on its age. And productivity, cost and quality, these are the main thing. And now, you see, if you look at it, big slide, don't bother, I'll just go through that. I mentioned these are the property requirements, fatigue and so on, and plant limitations I already mentioned, productivity, cost and quality. And there, you know, what are the techniques we use for each? You know, this is, for example, multi-phase CFD. Multi-phase CFD, why you have for liquid steel? You know, in the ladle, you do the refining. You know, you should give me a notice about 10, 15 minutes before. Okay, thank you. So that, you know, your professor, another 15 minutes is there. Okay, that's fine. Because you see, a professor is, I mean, he can go on. I mean, because we have also flexibility in the IIT system, 1 year, 1 hour or 2 hours, right? So therefore, that is there. Here, you have got CFD multiphase, you know, liquid. In the liquid, what are all there? Steel is there, then there is slag is there, then there is the third one, which is argon is bubbled from the bottom. Why do you bubble argon from the bottom? To carry away nitrogen you would have picked up, some sulfur if possible, and also, you know, the slag composition has to be carefully controlled so that FES is formed and it is removed so that your inclusion comes down. So it's a very complex problem, but ultimately, as I said, it is Navier-Stokes equation. So if your fundas are good, you will be able to survive. And multiphase CFD for and also thermal modeling. You know, those of you who have tried to model it this way, you will find it very difficult. Thermal modeling and also mass momentum transfer. So simultaneously solving equations which will satisfy the boundary conditions of all these problems is extremely difficult. And then production of, that aim is what? Prediction of macro and micro segregation, inclusion distribution. What is CET? Columnar to equiaxial. Because when you have a material solidifying, first solidifying, there will be a temperature gradient. It will be a columnar one. After some wall is formed, inside, it will be more or less homogeneous. You will have equiaxed. From a practical point of view, I should have as much of equiax structure and as little of columnar. So can you manage it? For that you require. And then thermomechanical models for crack and bulging. Bulging is a big problem in casting because, all the dissolved gases, as the temperature goes down, will come out. Under that pressure, what will happen is the casting will bulge. And also another thing that will happen is, one thing we found in Tata Steel, 3,000 times the continuous caster has been used. After that, suddenly the bulging problem was more. Then we realized wear and tear should be also one of the variables. So therefore, these are all very complex problems where heuristic as well as theoretical calculations will have to go. And then you have precipitates also coming out. And thermomechanical, all these things are happening as a continuously changing temperature. So that means there has to be a temperature set of equations also. That means you have to do mass balance, thermal balance, and overall energy balance, and fluid flow problems. All will have to be having a self-consistent solution. Earlier times we will go mad, but today, because of the availability of computers and high-performance computing, it is possible for us to solve these things fairly accurately. And then, when you go, after that you go to reheating, and there, all the precipitates have to be redissolved, grain growth will be there, for which you have to construct models, and then you have hot rolling, and when you are doing the hot rolling, those of you who remember recovery, recrystallization and all that, those words, for that you have to have models, and that too, as a gradually changing, and here you see you have to couple it with deformation. Deformation and thermal equations all to be simultaneously solved. If you see my book of 2001, written with Professor Rudolf Wasin of Moscow State University of Superplasticity, Phenomenology and Mechanics, we would have advocated that you do it first you solve in one, whether thermal balance, and then you try to use it to do that. Today it is not necessary, computer science has advanced so much, you can simultaneously solve. Because earlier we were doing it because you had to get some rough value and then refine it with the other value. It is no longer necessary. Computer can handle all the variations in both the thermal equations as well as in the deformation equations together. And this, you see, is a complex field. And then there is one thing which is, this is mainly for Professor Ranganathan. Runout table. There you see microstructure beautifully, runout table as well as in intercritical annealing, they are beautiful microstructures developed. And you see, when you think of that, what is the basis? This was given by a great man by the name of John Kahn. John Kahn's equation is today known as grand potential. But if you think, what is the basis of that? It is minimization of free energy. This is what Gibbs taught us. But the problem is, as I said in the early story, there are about 8 interfaces will come. When you put all of them together, it becomes a very complex equation, and that you see can be solved only by what is known as, it will have to be reduced to what is known as Landau-Ginzburg equation for grand potential, and you solve it. Both of them are Nobel laureates. People get frightened when they see the name. But it is simple thermodynamics minimization principle. Once you understand that, then it becomes easily handleable, and today fortunately there are many numerical techniques available in order to solve them. And then you see you come to cold rolling, and this is fortunately my area. I don't know Subhranshu Bhattacharya, I don't see him here. Is he there? There was one man called Prashant Date who was working. We were using this Marcinia, Kuczynski and all that. All those things are useful here in predicting the forming level. Date is of course in IIT Bombay now. He is a professor there. This kind of a thing, forming limit diagram. That means, supposing you want to produce a car body, one of the most complex applications of the extra deep drawing steel which is produced in the steel plants is making the oil sump for the heavy vehicles. Here, you see, you require enormous stretchability. So for that, your major strain as well as minor strain. Major strain means if you put a circle and deform it, it will become an ellipse. And the ellipse will have one major axis and one minor axis. So the strain along the major axis is known as major strain. One along the perpendicular direction is the minor strain. So both of them should be good. And to form that, it is extremely difficult. And all these things today can be calculated and you put over here. And I already talked about intercritical annealing, where the microstructure development takes place. All these things, if you go, and here, this is, I mean, a complex CFD, computational fluid dynamics, three phase. I want to only highlight this because it is a very interesting thing. Here, you know, we wanted to remove sulfur. As I said, sulfur should be as low as possible. And when we do that, you know, for that you have to have mass, momentum, turbulence, all of them will have to be balanced. And then you get your desulfurization, and you are able to also have your predictions for removal of, next slide will tell about nitrogen removal. And when you do that, you get the right kind of chemistry. And one interesting thing, this model we developed, you know, Tata Steel Holland, which I mentioned, they have got, earlier it was Corus. It was, unfortunately, he has disappeared at the right time. It was bought by Tata Steel during the time he was the MD. I mean, you know, Tata Steel went global during the time Muthuraman was MD, and the Corus was bought. So they have got excellent program, but somehow for this, the predictions which we have is superior to what Corus has. And what we do, usually, you know, we do a calculation and verify with some silly professor who would have published something. Obviously, that professor has been very accurate. So, with the result, our model is perfect. So, we have got an order now from Holland that we should develop ICME of the entire steel making, entire ICME of steel. So, this is a very interesting thing. And therefore, you know, there is something to be said for modeling and calculation. That is what I am basically trying to say. And of course, you know, these are horizontal integration. Basically, you know, what we do in the horizontal integration, there is ladle, tundish, caster, roller, annealing, and finally, you know, you get the sheet and all the properties. How you go back? I mean, I mentioned about auto steel, auto grade steel, and deep drawing steel. For this, carbon can be allowed only up to 30 ppm. Nitrogen also will have to be less than 30 ppm. And maximum inclusion size, 100 ppm, 100 micron. So all these things, you know, what you do is, earlier you used to do here and struggle with it. Now, even from here, you know, you will come here. So because of the horizontal integration, you are able to solve a problem you notice in step N, which originated at step A. So this is the power of the horizontal integration you can achieve. And here there is the vertical integration, which I talked about, you know, this sulfur and inclusion removal. And each one. So finally, of course, you know, this is ladle refining. I won't go into that. Tundish, how do you remove? And casting, you know, when you have, no problem. I'll finish that. That is why I already started jumping. As far as casting is concerned, you know, you have to also take into account a distribution. In the distribution, you have to be careful because the nitrogen level, etc., you know, has to be, the inclusions, etc., should be uniformly distributed. And so I come to here, and this I only mentioned. So this is again, you know, I mentioned about the Marciniak, Kuczynski and all. But the latest development is due to a man, again, IIT Madras product, Surya Kalidindi is the leading fellow. He is a professor at Georgia Tech, 1983 or 80, somewhere around that he passed B.Tech from civil engineering. He has moved into this. Surya is now trying to do a beautiful thing. You know, because you see, texture people will tell you, if it is a two-phase material, texture cannot be predicted. What Surya is doing is simple. Do with single crystal, one direction, some data you generate for any number of things. Then he does a beautiful discrete Fourier transforms, and with a few selected values, he is able to predict the forming limit diagram and so on. So this is something which is going, which is just implemented because this fellow, Akash Gupta, is doing PhD with him. I mean, he is an employee of TCS. And then, you know, we have also got decision support system. This is where managers come in. For them, you know, for example, this is all our back room. that is perfect models. And from there, you know, we create a lumped model, Tundish, and then casting model. And here, you know, this is what is called compromise decision support protocol. This is a statistical based, you know, basically, I will explain it to the next one. You see, for example, there is something known as center line segregation. That means all the precipitates, if they come along the center line of the rolled product, that is the worst you can have. It will have what is called crocodiling. Like the crocodile opens its mouth, the sheet will open its mouth. So this crocodiling problem means you are gone. So that is to be avoided. So that is one variable. Another is oscillation mark depth. That is, that explains your turbulence. When you are tapping it, what you have, if you do it in a very agitated way, that mark will go up and down. That cannot be beyond a certain value if you want to have a quality product. And the third one is, of course, naturally productivity. I have to do it as fast as possible also. So therefore, if I want to compromise among the three, what you try to do is you don't go for the peak, somewhere flat, and then, you know, we have got this particular thing. For example, CSL, variables we are considering is center line segregation, oscillation, mark depth, then columnar to equiaxed region, equiaxed fraction, productivity, cost. For all of them, you know, the managers will give a certain target value, and then, you know, from this model what we are getting, and all of them are satisfied. So this is a very powerful technique which also we have used. Now, this is something futuristic, because in an educational institution, it is not good to end with this is the current state, because we have to talk of something future as well. So this is where, of course, you know, Mrs. Ranganathan will be very happy, others may not be, because it's a very complex mathematical equation. Variables are just made into these kind of, you know, this is, if you think hard, it is the, you know, spectral theory, if you are familiar with in physics, this can be done. What we try to do is, I mean, what Surya Kalidindi is trying to do is spectral crystal plasticity. You know, crystal plasticity means all orientations I have to solve. I mean, that's very complex. So if I select a few which are the most dominant, from there you will describe, you may not be able to get 100%, it will be almost close to that. Then, you know, you are able to do the whole thing in 4% of the total time your computer takes. So therefore, this is a remarkable step forward which we want to introduce. And of course, you know, data science, which I mentioned a bit earlier, you know, how you want to integrate all of them, that is processing, structure and properties, there, that is there. And this is done by, you know, this PCA is partial component analysis. You know, those of us have Banaras background will remember of M.L. Kapoor. Madanlal Kapoor was one of the first ones to work on linear programming in iron and steel making. So this is, he has gone very far, and this is an excellent kind of tool we have. So that way, you know, data science can also be brought in. And finally, you know, well, this is the last slide, where in fact, you know, you say, what is it that I have done? All, forget about all the detailed mathematics which I mentioned. In the ladle, what do you do? Am I meeting the sulfur? If it is not, you know, you change the purging time, purging rate and time. Next, Tundish, am I maintaining the temperature correctly? Otherwise, precipitation and all that will give you problem. If that is not happening, change the dam, the wear height and position. In the caster, you have to bother about sulfur as well as inclusion. If it is not working, change the CS means casting speed, then superheat and cooling rate. Here, hot rolling, are you getting, this is the finish rolling temperature, this is grain size, then, you know, change roll schedule and temperature. And runout table, you have to, is the fraction of ferrite, is it what you want? Grain size, if it is not, change the cooling rate. And properties, of course, you predict, if it is not, change the whole thing. So this is where, you know, the integrated computational engineering is useful. This gives you an idea about what we have tried to solve. Of course, we have used some of these ANSYS, you can see everywhere. This is a very powerful, common, cheap software. This is the only one we have used from outside. Rest are all either experimental data culled out from the literature. This is no big deal for TCS to do. All we have to do is ask one fellow to collect it, and empirical models and knowledge, whichever we have. And all of them are there. These are home-written software, TCS, all that, and precipitate evolution, grain size. So we have got a full thing. And so this is the kind of a story which we have today. And as I said at the beginning, it is no longer a dream. In fact, already, you know, the other day I was told very pleasantly that one of the products, these are all details I cannot talk about in greater detail. One of the verticals, TTS verticals, wants to even take it as one of their tools. So therefore, it has gone to such an advanced level. Already, as I said, it is being implemented in, you disappeared at the right time when I was telling about Holland, because it was acquired when he was the MD. We are already implementing it in Chorus, not ex-Chorus, today's Tata Steel Holland and Jamshedpur. And also in Bombardier, of course, mostly on composite materials and not on steel. And again, you know, one thing is, it has been a wonderful experience for me. As I tell the CTO, you are paying me some money for allowing me to learn every day something new. And with these 25 fellows, every day each fellow coming up with this, I have learned so many mathematical techniques, which I didn't know until I started on this program. So it is a very positive experience. In fact, I remember a great saying, one of my teachers used to tell it often, I have learned good things from my teachers, but the greatest things I learned from my students. So this is what I am doing. Along with them, it has been a glorious experience. And we are already talking in terms of extending it to other areas. And also, I want to use it as artificial intelligence, coupling it with it, so that, you know, for example, you are doing a research in some area and where you want to know what all other people have done. You should be able to press a button like a search engine, it gives you whatever you want. And through AI, it can be trained to even your thinking. So in fact, you know, one of the aims we have is to replace Padmanabhan with whatever he thinks. This is one of the things. And I am quite happily being a guinea pig because I am already 73. So that is it. With that, I would like to take leave.
Thank you, Professor Padmanabhan, for this very interesting and very impressive, very informative talk on ICME as applied to the steel industry. Since we have the next event starting at 3 o'clock, in the interest of time, if there are any questions, I would like this to be taken up after the event. So
one or two, someone has raised their hand before you said that.
The last question, please.
Professor, you talked about crocodiling. We were working with Tata's micro-alloy steel plates. And during fabrication, we were not able to find the defect during the non-destructive testing. But after fabrication, these steel plates used to open up in the center, and we had enormous problems because we were erecting them on the bucket wheel excavators. And right on top we used to have these problems, and we had to put bolts and nuts, huge nuts and bolts, to hold it in position.
Yeah, that means you should get better NDT equipment or better NDT advisors. And I would like to do a promotional activity for IIT Madras. There is one fellow sitting there called Madhusudan. Madhusudan is a B.Tech from, one of the poor fellows who had the torture of going through. He runs a company. He will help you. Please contact him. Point is, today we have got techniques which can even measure less than 2 micron size. So if you have missed something which leads to crocodiling, there is some serious problem. Precisely that is what I told you. Crocodiling takes place only when you are rolling, not before. Before, everything will look nice. Have you heard of delayed cracking? Yes. Delayed cracking, that is what is happening. You see, when you are going towards cracking, you get into a thermodynamic metastable state. So it remains there. But it can't be a stable state. After some time, you know, the activation barrier gets crossed and it starts opening. This is much more complicated. In, you know, one thing when I was in IIT Madras, we had to do this problem. Stainless steel, you know, was becoming very expensive. And so they wanted to reduce the nickel content. They brought it down to 1%, which finally, you know, we okayed it. You know, because you see, Algeny Ludlam made something lower than the austenitic stainless steel. Salem steel is the benchmark during the Second World War, 4.5. We didn't have any international standard. And, you know, all these fellows, you know, many of the forging industry people and sheet metal farmers, when you go there, you will forget all your metallurgy. Suddenly, you will ask, patta tayar hai. You know, he won't even know sheet tayar hai, patta tayar hai. This is the word they will use. And such things, you know, are there. And but still, you know, up to 1% we allowed. But you see, people were greedy. They went to 0.8, 0.7 and so on. When this went into the Bombay market, I mean, it was disaster. Because suddenly, you know, the cans will open out. Like, I mean, as they used to say, these are all very well-known season cracking or delayed cracking. So therefore, if you introduce a highly stressed material into the market without proper post-treatment, this is always bound to happen. Okay.
Let's thank the speaker once again. May I request Professor Kamaraj to hand over the memento to the speaker, please.
Okay, we can go?
Yes. May I now request Prof. Bal Subramanian to give the vote of thanks.
Brief vote of thanks. So first of all, I thank our beloved Professor K. Padmanabhan for the wonderful talk. And second, I would like to thank the contributors. So, Pakraj, Mr. Pakraj, and Mrs. Lakshmi Chandra, and Mrs. Paru, and Mohammed Rosan, Dr. Srikant, and Mr. Dasaradi. So, because of their generous contributions, so we are able to run this program every year. And third, I would like to thank the institute administration. They helped in various ways. The last but not the least, the audience. So any lecture series will not be good without the audience support. So even though it's a Saturday afternoon, so you turned up in large numbers. So I thank you all. Thank you.